Okay, Max. Welcome to our online worship service. I'm Pastor Steve Kienberger from First Lutheran Church in Astoria, Oregon, and we're joined by Peace Lutheran Church, the two ELCA congregations in Astoria, and we are pleased to offer this online worship for you on this third Sunday after Pentecost. And if you would like to follow along with the worship, you may go to our website and download this program or bulletin and follow along with the worship service. This is also known as Father's Day, or celebrated as Father's Day in the United States. And so I invite Carol Smith up to lead us in our Father's Day blessing.
A welcome and Father's Day blessing. Please join me in the bold type. God of all creation, pour out your blessings on all fathers.
And those who provide fatherly care.
You have made them in your image.
And given them children to love and care for in your name.
Bless them with a heart like your heart.
Discerning and thoughtful, bold and decisive, compassionate and loving.
As they model for their children,
the life that is lived by faith and not by sight.
Grant them courage under pressure
and confidence in your power.
When troubles threaten to overwhelm them,
grant them your hope and calm.
When doubts give rise to anxiety,
shore up their trust in your promises.
When joy fills their days,
grant them a keen gratitude for your abundant supply of grace.
Season them with a lively sense of humor, Lord.
For it will make life richer for us all.
In all circumstances, preserve them as your own.
We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We continue our worship with the hymn, "This Is My Father's World," hymn 824 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship Hymnal.
Oh,
greet you with that ancient of greetings with words from the Apostle Paul. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we do your will, through Jesus Christ our Savior and Lord. Amen. Well, we take a brief moment now for a children's message. And so I'm going to ask Max, and if Sequoia's out there, if she wants to come forward. And I just have a gather with me here. I have a quick question for you. And and then we're going to go to a little video. So you, both you and Sequoia, were part of Vacation Bible School in Astoria last year. Max, tell me, Sequoia, tell me, what was your favorite part?
The playtime where you got, and that was my last station of the day, so.
Your last station of the day was playtime. Oh, playtime. Well, this year we're going to do, because of the COVID or the coronavirus, we can't gather like we wished last year. And so we have to do an online version of that. And when you get home, I want you all and all of you there to watch this little video that's going to talk about the Apostle Paul's dangerous journey to spread the truth of God's love in Jesus Christ. So our Vacation Bible School is all going to be about how the Apostle Paul went out and all the hardships and all the things he went through and the joys to spread the love of God through Jesus Christ. So have fun watching this very shameless plug for Vacation Bible School, which starts this Monday.
In the Bible, you can read about a guy named Saul. Saul followed God, but Saul didn't believe in Jesus. In fact, Saul didn't like Christians at all. Saul even had some Christians arrested. But God had big plans for Saul. God blinded Saul with a bright light. Then God spoke to him. When Saul could see again, he was completely changed. Even his name was changed to Paul. Paul spent the rest of his life traveling to different cities, telling people about Jesus. It was hard and dangerous work. Some people were really mean to Paul, but Paul never gave up. He wanted everyone to know the truth about God's love. You can read about Paul's dangerous journey in the Bible. Or come to Athens VBS and hear about Paul's adventures from Paul himself. You won't want to miss it.
First scripture reading for this third Sunday after Pentecost is taken from the sixth chapter of Romans, verses 6 through 11. Paul writes, "Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us have been baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? Therefore we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. For if we've been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. but the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourself dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us proclaim our gospel acclamation for this Sunday. Alleluia, Jesus says, the Spirit of the Lord will testify on my behalf, and you also are to testify. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the 12, a disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace be unto you all from our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus. Amen. This is perhaps a hard gospel text to take for Father's Day, for fathers and mothers, for parents. After that long, whoever does not deny father and mother, whoever does not deny themselves even and take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Well, what is this talk of denial and of crosses at the beginning of summer season? A family tradition of mine was to watch each Halloween evening the cartoon film It's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown. It is a film that conjoins and confuses Halloween and Christmas, the giving of treats at Halloween with the giving of treats at Christmas. Of course, in Linus's mind, the Peanuts character that fabricates the Great Pumpkin takes the place of Santa Claus. And Linus gives up trick-or-treating to wait in the pumpkin patch for the arrival of the Great Pumpkin and all these gifts that he's going to bring. Charlie Brown, torn in loyalty to his friend Linus and going trick-or-treating with the other kids, chooses finally to go trick-or-treating with the others who receive the expected various goodies, except for Charlie Brown, who always laments, all I got was a rock. Sometimes I wonder if we view the Christian life or God like a Charlie Brown Christmas or Halloween cartoon. It isn't too far off to mention Christmas on this day, as yesterday was the summer solstice, the 20th of June, and this coming Wednesday is celebrated in the church as the festival of St. John the Baptist, a day that is usually passed over without notice or much notice at all in our culture, but in Europe, it's celebrated with great festivities, with bonfires and the celebration of midsummer. St. John's Day always falls on June 24, which marks the birth of this cousin and forerunner to Jesus. And it is exactly 6 months before Christmas. Not to put any pressure on you all, but we like to think sometimes of the Christian faith as one which promises a life of prosperity or ease. But we know that this is not the intent of the gospel. We might, like Charlie Brown, think as others get their treats, look, all we get is a cross. Indeed, our gospel today ends with the words to Jesus' disciples, whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Makes me appreciate the hymn Amazing Grace so much more. I once was lost, but now am found. Finding our lives, that's what we want. We want to find ourselves and find our purpose and find our goal. And the gospel tells us it's not about you finding, but in a sense, being found. Giving your life to Jesus, to the cross, picking up your cross, following Jesus, you will find your life. Today's gospel continues Matthew's discourse about mission and the cost of discipleship. This gospel reveals the story of Matthew's community told to them after they've already chosen to follow Jesus Christ. The members of this community knew the radical demands of preaching the good news and proclaiming the reign of God in Jesus Christ. They saw it lead Jesus to the cross. They knew that this call was an absolute commitment surpassing even the bonds of family. Jesus' message compelled them, in the name of being a disciple, to share their hospitality and service even to the lowly and least ones in their community, in their society, in the world. Crucifixion was a cruel method of execution, and those who died on the cross were often left hanging by the side of the road as an example and deterrent to others who would get in the way of Rome, the powers of Rome, and of empire. Jesus' followers had seen Jesus die on the cross, their friend, their Lord, their Savior. They knew too that their witness and preaching might lead them to that very cross, and they might also lose their lives, their loved ones, and all that they held dear. Yet they preached a message of life through the cross. Their commitment to follow Jesus was absolute. Their commitment might get them in trouble with their own immediate family even. As the gospel says, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. This absolute call to discipleship, it can get in the way of lots of people's feelings and of our own family members' ideas of the good life. In our gospel for today, Jesus contrasts our biological family and its household with our spiritual family and the household of God. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? Calling those who follow Jesus lost, somehow errant in their ideas and in their way. If they call Jesus and proclaim him a deviant, how much more those who follow after him? Well, where might God's household be in conflict with the world's household or sense of being at home? Who might be in need of a guest room in God's household? Where might we find them? Perhaps as the cross was a place of degradation and pain, a pain and a suffering, a degradation that Jesus embraced, perhaps we ought to look in similar places in the world. Where are those who need a guest room filled with hope? Perhaps those in migrant camps need a hospitable place to rest and be refreshed from the pain of backbreaking work. Maybe it's those who have lost their savings and lives in struggles of corporate greed who need a guest room to find a voice to speak against injustice. Perhaps it's a family struggling to live on the rations of welfare who needs a guest room of generosity and new dreams. In this time of racial divide, division, and calls for repentance and reparation for those who are disenfranchised and at whose expense the American dream was given to others, perhaps they are in need of a listening ear and a attentive heart, not judgmental, but open and asking to learn together, following the way of Jesus. Well, dear friends, there are only 6 months until Christmas. Let me ask you this: what will the household of God look like in the next 6 months? How will you imagine the household of God? How might our two communities, I'm speaking now to our own First Lutheran and Peace Lutheran Church, how will we grow together in the next 6 months and form something new here in Astoria? We might end up losing our life, losing it, I hope, for the sake of Jesus Christ. We might find a greater life in the household of God. Amen. May that be so. Amen. I invite you now to sing together this wonderful hymn, I Love to Tell the Story, hymn 661 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship. one another and the whole creation. Let us pray for our shared world. Expansive God, you bring diverse voices together to form your church. Open our hearts and unstop our ears to learn from one another, that differences might not overshadow our baptismal unity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Providing God, your creation shows us that life comes from death. Renew the places where our land, air, and waterways have been ill for too long. Direct the work of all who care for birds and their habitats. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Protecting God, sustain and keep safe all who work to defend others across the world, especially those from our own congregation who serve in the military and who are listed in our bulletin, and those whom we carry in our hearts and minds. Revive and strengthen organizations dedicated to caring for refugees and migrants while their homelands struggle for peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, you promise to be with all who are persecuted for your sake. Guide all who speak your word of justice and console any who are tormented or targeted for being who they are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, you are with us and we are never alone. Bless all fathers and father figures who strive to love and nurture as you do. Comfort all who long to be fathers and all for whom this day may be difficult. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, at this time of national division and strife, of pandemic illness, we pray for all who are called to serve and care for our community. We ask, dear Lord, that we would have hearts that would be open to one another, to listen and to heed your call for the great diversity that you have created and set in place. Help us come to greater understanding and justice. Be with all who care for those who are sick and affected by this pandemic, for doctors and nurses, for emergency workers, for those who care, family members, loved ones, friends and neighbors. Keep us safe and protect us from all harm. Give us the assurance that you give in the gospel. Do not be afraid. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Reigning God, you bless us with guides and caretakers in the faith. As we give thanks for those who have died, increase our care for one another until we walk with them in newness of life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now receive this benediction. The Holy Three, the Holy One, increase your hope, strengthen your faith, deepen your love, and grant you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, hymn 836 in the Evangelical Lutheran Worship. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Yeah, Bart. It's working, say it.
Happy Father's Day to all the fathers.
Right now. Happy Father's Day.
Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
Again. Happy Father's Day.
Right where you are.
Right now?
On the camera.
Okay. I wish everybody a happy Father's Day.
Out there.
Happy Father's Day.
Please wish everybody a happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day.
I want to take this time to wish everyone a happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day!
In our worship service, it's always nice to greet each other at a safe distance and to know who people are, because I don't think everyone knows, especially the First and Peace people, and so this is a time for us to get to know each other. So we'll go around, and so I'll invite the people at home or those viewing and all to join in with us right here, and I'll move out of the way.
Okay,
so I come up now? Yeah, you come up now. So I'll do a welcome and, you know, greeting, and then say, Carol Smith will lead us in the Father's Day blessing. On with reading Romans 6, and then we have the Gospel, Acclamation, Holy Gospel, and then I'll move up to the here for the sermon. Okay.
And then we discover the photographer has no film.